did one a couple months ago. Wait, maybe it was a couple weeks ago. And I told her before, I said, if he did it, I would do it. So, I'm just going to tell you, Karen said what God's laid on my heart. So in the time of trouble, we can run to the secret place, so there's too, under the place is the shadow of the Almighty. We can dwell in the shadow, under the shadow of the Almighty. Isaiah 25:4 says, it says, "For thou hast been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy." For thou hast been a strength to the poor, a strength to the needy, in his distress, a refuge from the storm, a shadow from the heat, when the blast of the terrible one is at the storm. So he's a protection from the storms that come in our life. He's a shadow from the heat, and when you're abiding with Jesus, you will have protection, but you must be close to abide under the shadow of God. If you're dwelling with Jesus, and when the storms of life come, you won't get burnt as bad because you're already under the shadow when the storms of life come. And so, we should be abiding with Jesus to dwell in the secret place, and then to abide under the shadow of the Almighty. John 15:1-4. This chapter talks about abiding the vine and the branches, and we should be abiding in him to bear fruit. Verses 1-4 say, "I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch that in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purges it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken to you. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me." So we're supposed to abide in him to gain our strength. And when the children of life come, we'll always have a place to come back to, because he's our help, and we can't do anything without him, so we need to abide with him in order to be satisfied. And then number two is we should abide in him because of the protection that he gives back to our Psalm 91. In verse 2, it says, "I will say to the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, and him will I trust." So our God is a refuge, and a refuge. I'm saying Psalm 71. You guys can say this. I'm saying a lot of this. A refuge is a shelter that protects in danger, distress, or calamity. It's a stronghold which protects by strength. And so God is a refuge for us. In Psalm 71, verse 3, it says, "Be thou my strong habitation, whereunto I may continually resort. Thou hast given commandment to save me, for thou art my rock and my fortress." So our God is a refuge for us. A refuge doesn't stop the calamity or the trials from happening outside. You run to a refuge to get peace from the storms outside, and you run into it, and there's peace inside. So Psalms 46 is a familiar chapter because it talks about, "Be still and know that I am God." In verses 1 and 2 it says, "God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, though the earth be moved, and though the mountains be carried into the distance." So we're supposed to be along with God in order to have that refuge and that strength. And we don't have to worry. Like, I'm a big worrier. I worry about a lot of things. But when we have him as a refuge, we can have peace because he knows what he's doing and he's trustworthy. And then he's also our shield and buckler in Psalms 91. In verse 4 it says, "He shall cover thee with his feathers, and under his wings shall thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler." So a buckler, I didn't know what this meant until I looked it up. But it's a kind of shield or a piece of defensive armor. It protects from things that may happen on us. 6:16 talks about the armor of God and about the shield of faith. And we need to have that shield of faith in order to guard from the enemy and the lies that he may bring at us. And God will protect us from that. Because we need to trust him. If we trust in his truth and trust in what he says, then he'll protect us from the lies of the enemy trying to get into us and steal our glory. Just trust in his truth and obey him when it doesn't make sense because he knows what he's doing. also our fortress. A fortress is any fortified place, stronghold, in place of defense or security. So it's kind of like a refuge. Back in Psalm 71, I'm gonna go to Psalm 71, the last point, so you guys can stay there. Verse 3, it says, Be thou my strong habitation, whereto I may continually resort. Thus given commandment to save you, for thou art my rock and my hope. So David made God his fortress. David made God his strong habitation. A habitation is a settled dwelling. So David was continually dwelling with God, continually resorting to him and going back to him. He was continually seeking the face of God. He didn't wait to determine why it came or the what came into his life, he didn't wait for that to bring him back to God. He was already there when that night came. David also made God his rock, as we see in verse 3. He made him his firm foundation. In Matthew 7, 24 through 27,
oh, yeah,
it talks about the wise man who built his house upon a rock. And when the storms came, he wasn't moved because he was sat on what God said. He obeyed God. And so, when the strength of life came to David, he was firm because he was on God. 1 Corinthians 15:58 says, therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of God. So we should be steadfast in our faith, we should be steadfast in what God's told us to do.
Yeah.
Because we need him as a rock, because we won't be able to live this life alone. Because the other man, the foolish man in Matthew 7, he fell because he built his life on other things, like money or things that don't satisfy, that don't fulfill us. Hebrews 13:8 says Jesus Christ is saying us today. So God never changes, so that's why we should build it our life upon the rock, because he never changes. He never will change. So he's been good before, he will be good.
Yeah, that's right.
So the circumstances of our life may change, but if you're grounded in Jesus, you will stand firm and unshaken. So dwell with him so you can stand firm. You can write down Colossians 22:23 if you want to look at it later. Number 3, you should dwell with God because of the person you're called. We're dwelling with God, which is awesome. But I'm going to read verse 2 again. It says, I will save the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. We can trust him. As I said, he's never going to fail. And so we can trust in that God said it is true. We can trust his character. And in Psalm 71, it's a really good chapter. We read it for a thing one night before that I preached. And it was a really good chapter. I went home and I sent it out. And it's talking about David from his future. So he's old. In verse 5, it says, thou art my hope, O Lord God, thou art my trust for my youth. And then he goes to verse 9, it says, cast me not off and will catch all my feet. And then verse 17, O God, thou hast taught me from my youth. And then verse 18, now also, when I am old and broken. So David's gone back from his youth to when he's old.
Mm-hmm.
And he's showing hope. He's showing how God sees people. We see God never left him, even if he sinned. He moments in his life where he got away from God and sinned, but God never left him.
Yeah.
His life is an example of God's goodness. Psalms 37:5 is a great chapter. You can go home and read it. But verse 25 says, I have been young and now I am old, yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor see they be progress. So we should trust in God, because he will never fail us. We should follow him because he stays faithful. I said that a lot. Which is 3 through 7 of chapter 37. Trust in the Lord and do good. Show yourself out to all the land, and verily thou shalt be found. Confide thyself also in the Lord, and he shall give thee the desires of thy heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in him, and he shall bring it to pass. He shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, thy judgment as the noonday. Rest and the Lord, wait patiently for him, but not for self, because of him who prospers in the way, in his way, because of the man who brings wicked devices. So we should trust in the Lord, we should divide ourselves in the Lord, we should commit our ways to the Lord, and we should rest in God, rest in his character, because he fully satisfies. And no matter if you do that, and no matter what circumstances of your life you are in, you'll be able to patiently wait for him. After this Sunday school, the pastor was gone, he said this, and it really stuck with me. When you have patience with God, you trust character. Yeah, you're fine. The protection you get and the person you dwell with, because we thought it was like this.
Amen.